Hello, everyone. I'm Stephen Hardy, Editorial Director of Broadband Technology Report, and it's my pleasure to welcome you to today's BTR webcast, in which you'll learn all about Technetics' one-touch network solution. Our webinar today is sponsored by Technetics, whom we thank for their help in making today's event possible. So cable cos around the world are looking for ways to improve the capacity and efficiency of their HFC networks. Today, we're going to look at Technetics' approach towards helping operators achieve those goals. We'll do so by being joined by Jan Arison, Chief Technology Officer at Technetics. Jan is an accomplished engineer with over 39 years of experience in the broadband cable industry. Jan currently leads the CTO as well as the marketing, R&D, and QA teams at Technetics. He was appointed to his role as Chief Technical Officer in 2012 and has since been responsible for the creation of innovative technologies and products that improve customers' network performance while driving down the cost of ownership. Jan's focus is on liaising with customers to establish their needs and to be the Technetics technology advocate, developing new technologies and product platforms with them in mind. Jan was also appointed to Technetics' main board in 2018. Now, before I pass things off to Jan, let me quickly review our webcast setup for those of you who are here for the first time or the first time in a long time. I'll start with the Ask a Question box that you should see at the bottom of your screens. I invite you to feel free to use this to ask questions at any time during the event today. To submit a question, just click in the box, type in your question, and hit the send button. Jan will address your questions after he's completed his presentation. Now, in the event you run into a technical problem during the webinar, you can call for help using that Q&A tool as well. Just describe your problem, hit the question submission button, and David, who's today's webcast technician, will be happy to help you out. Next, if you know of someone who might benefit from seeing this webcast or you just want to see it again, this event will be available on demand from our archive for the next 6 months. We'll send you an email with a link to that archive sometime in the next day or so that you should feel free to pass along to your coworkers. And the archive version of the webcast will also be accessible from the Broadband Technology Report website, www.broadbandtechreport.com. Just look for the word webcast above the main navigation bar. Click on that. Find this webcast at the top of the list that you'll be presented with. Click on the title. And then on the landing page, click either register or view this webcast and you'll be in. Now, if you'd like a copy of today's slides, you can find them via the event resources tab that you should see on your screens right below the Ask a Question box. Just click in the tab to reveal them. And finally, if you'd like a certificate of attendance, perhaps for continuing education purposes, hang on until the end of the event and I'll let you know how to get your hands on one. And with that, let's begin as I hand things over to Jan Arison, CTO of Technetics. Jan, it's all yours.
Thank you. Thank you, Stephen. And welcome everybody into the Technetics studio in the Netherlands. Today, we want to tell you more about OneTouch, the OneTouch networks. So during this presentation, I want to tell you something about the company overview. What is OneTouch? We also want to talk about the DNN technology and the DNN products that we have developed to make this technology, the business case and the conclusion slides. First, we want to tell you something about Technetics, just a few slides before we go over to this part. Technetics, in fact, is founded in 1990. We deliver roughly into 70 countries. We do have technical centers in different parts of the world. We are a healthy, financial healthy company, and we deliver roughly to 1,195 different customers. So I hope you understand, we cannot put all the logos here, but just a few of them. So we are delivered this worldwide, Africa, America, South America, Australia, Asia, Europe, everywhere. Our drive is and always has been, let's try to make the impossible possible. Let's try to invent something that didn't exist. Let's come up with something that not only solve your problem now, but also will solve your problem in the future. That is the main part of our drive. Doing this, we have developed a number of different products. We have about 135 different patents on those products. And you see just a few of the products that we have built here. We have a dedicated technical center in the Netherlands, in the UK, US, Canada, Germany, and Belgium, where we develop all those different style of products. The as I said, we always try to do the extra mile. We know you have the reason to buy from us, and we want to give you that reason. And that's why we want to make something that you can use in the future. And this whole DNN approach, this one-touch approach, comes out of that drive. So the if I look to that, what is a one-touch network? And just to give you an overview, what are we going to discuss today is more about if you install your network, you install it once and you never go back. Your network is there now to finish. This is the last upgrade you need for a long, long, long time. That is the drive. So what we are doing, we are unlocking the spectrum up to 1800 megahertz. We are using the guard bands also for transmission. We don't want to lose that prime spectrum in the middle. We want to start using it also for transmission. And doing that, we unlock this area between 54 and 492 megahertz. We will tell you how we do this and how this works during the presentations. So in fact, what we do, after installation, you can still decide where to put a split. And if you want to change your split, it's free of your choice. You can go in every direction you want with the split, because you don't have to make the decision now. At the end, it's software. It is the remote PHY or the remote MAC-PHY and the modem will decide where the split is, not your network anymore. And that's why we say, yeah, this makes the impossible possible, because even within the upstream, we can still have mandatory downstream channels, like out-of-band channels, for instance. And that is something that this technology will bring, and it is backwards compatible, but also forward compatible up to DOCSIS 4 ultra-high split. And it even will show you in these slides that we have about 30 to 35% power reduction compared to what you have now. So these are the things we want to highlight during this presentation. So what is DNN? So when you look to the different spectrums that at the moment that people have, you have DOCSIS 3.0, 42-54 megahertz split. In Europe, it's 65-85. We call this low split. Most operators are still here and are now moving towards DOCSIS 3.1 high split. And that high split mainly is 204-258. So we are increasing our upstream to that area. And then there is also some talk about DOCSIS 3.1 plus. 3.1 plus will go to 1400 megahertz. So we add one OFDM block on the top. But also by doing that, we can increase the upstream to a 300 megahertz split. So it is a little bit more than DOCSIS 3.1. Something that you can do with existing components in your network that you don't have to upgrade everything. And now we are focusing also on DOCSIS 4. DOCSIS 4, you have at the moment two variations of that, where we talk about ESD, extended spectrum DOCSIS, where we go to 1800 megahertz, and then the split can be on different parts, can be, for instance, 396, 492, we call it ultra-high split, or 492, 606, or even up to 684, 834. So you can have different areas where to put the split between upstream and downstream. That is extended spectrum DOCSIS. Then, of course, we have full duplex DOCSIS. Full duplex DOCSIS goes still to 1200 megahertz. But that, and then you have an area between 100 and 684, or between 85 and 684, where you can have full duplex. So it can go up and down at the same time. So your remote PHY will decide, he can communicate 100 megahertz and he can receive 100 megahertz. That's what this area is. So what you are doing, you are increasing your upstream while you are not taking it away from your downstream. And the part that we want to talk about, we call it DOCSIS 4 DNN, direction neutral networks. Direction neutral networks means that between 85 and 492, again, is the same as full duplex. It's not dedicated anymore. It doesn't matter, it can be upstream or it can be downstream. It's not and, it's or downstream. So that means it's a half duplex system, but that directly goes to 1800 megahertz. So it gives you the benefit of ESD and gives you also the benefit of full duplex DOCSIS. Because if you now look more into this, into full duplex DOCSIS have a number of advantages because your network stays at 1.2 gigahertz. And therefore, you don't have to upgrade your taps, etc., in your network. Huge benefit of full duplex DOCSIS. Yeah? It's just if you have to upgrade, it's just a faceplate swap on your taps. Yeah? And you are going to use much more efficient use of your existing bandwidth. The disadvantage is that, in fact, full duplex DOCSIS is developed for an N plus zero network. And there are options to go to an N plus two, N plus three with a full duplex DOCSIS amplifiers, but it's very complex, very power hungry solution. Another thing is that the isolation in your taps becomes more critical, because those isolation that you have in your taps, you will deal with interference groups and so on. What you need to handle the groups for full duplex communication. So it's at the end, it's an expensive rebuild to go for full duplex DOCSIS. Then you have ESD. ESD will have the same structure as 1.2 gigahertz. So it is, you can have amplifiers. You can have an N plus 3 or an N plus 5 like you have now. That's an advantage of extended spectrum DOCSIS. You don't need special amplifiers. You need 1.8 gigahertz amplifiers. To do that, it's a very easy installation because you are replacing amplifiers for amplifiers and taps for taps. And it is quite widely accepted in the industry. But the disadvantage is on the higher frequencies, you have a higher loss. And therefore, you need bigger amplifiers that will have more power consumption, or you have to go to a DGA solution or with booster amplifiers, because booster amplifiers will help you to reach the next amplifier without really driving your power consumption through the roof. That's a solution that you can do. But the big disadvantage of extended spectrum DOCSIS is that you have to swap all components in your network to 1.8, including the black boxes, because black boxes in taps cannot deal with 1.8 gigahertz signals. They have the notch for the make before break switch and the connectors are not good enough. This was till 3-4 months the case. Luckily, we can tell you that we solved this part. We now have a faceplate that you can replace into your existing back box and still go to 1.8 gigahertz. So this gives you a big advantage that the same as what you have here, where you need to swap faceplates. Also here, you need to swap faceplates, and you don't have to swap your back box anymore. That will be a big saver on your OPEX cost, that you don't have to go in the field, recharacterize it, mount a new back box, etc. And then, of course, as we discussed, we have the DNN, the direction neutral networks. And the fact, as you can see, it almost takes the advantages of both technologies in one, because it still is the same structure as 1.2 gigahertz. So you can drive 3 to N plus 3 or N plus 5, the same as what you do here. It's very easy installation, but you are still making more efficient use of your bandwidth from the full duplex part. So you can copy, in fact, you are copying the advantages of both technologies inside this area. It has by far the highest throughput into the signals compared to the other two, because it has 1.8 and has the advantage of full duplex DOCSIS areas. And it's a medium power. It is at the end, what you will see later on in the calculations, as I said in the beginning, we will save about 30% on the power compared to what you have now. The disadvantage is, in some cases, you have to look to the levels and so on, and maybe you have to recalculate your network, but you don't have to respace. You can leave the amplifiers as is, et cetera. But that's something that we have to look into. Depends on the customers, what they have. And yes, you still need a 1.8 gigahertz products, of course, because DNN will go to 1.8 gig. But again, you don't have to swap back boxes. It's just a faceplate replacement. So what is DNN? If I look to that, maybe it's easier to explain that you have a node, then you have your downstream signal going to the CPE, and you have from the CPE, you have your upstream signal going to the node. And your downstream can start at 54, 85, 108, 204, 258, doesn't matter. Start somewhere and goes to 1800 megahertz. And your way back, in fact, starts at 5 and goes to 492. So you see that between, in this example, between 54 and 492, they overlap. It can be upstream or downstream. And if you zoom into this area, then you will see that, in fact, a signal like this is feasible, where you have upstream up to 54 megahertz, then you have carriers up or down, it can be both, and then from 492 on, it's downstream only. And because you have no filters in your network, this is an example, but also can be something like this, or it can be something like this, or something like this. You can constantly change it. You can swap carriers, because there is no dedication filter anymore in your network. So your network doesn't matter if it's up or down. It is just a transparent pipe. All the signals that come down gets going down, and all the signals that come up gets going up. And that's the whole idea about DNN networks, that we are not listed anymore or limited anymore with filters. A good, the way how we try to explain this is by cars. So please stay with me this way. So let's assume that you have a big city here, and in the morning you have a huge traffic jam going into your city. Out of your city is very easy because there's not a lot of cars there, so you can drive fast here, but you don't, you cannot drive fast into the city. And probably in the evening, it's the other way around, because then all these cars have to go out of the city, and then it's very easy to come into the city. So if you are unlucky and you're both sides, you have to work in the city, so in the morning you're in a traffic jam, and in the evening you're in a traffic jam. This is the same as on the coax. You have an upstream and you have a downstream, and you have a filter to separate up and down. That's what you have as well at the moment. So what DNN is doing, first of all, it will take away the barrier here. So you have five rows instead of four, because you have no crossover, you have no guard band anymore. And then you can put cars everywhere. It's just decided on the software where you want to put the cars. So therefore, as example, it can be something like this, where you have a lot of cars going in that direction and just a few cars going in this direction. So there's a lot of downstream, just a little upstream. And you can see we have no middle carrier anymore. So we can transport much more cars in this example. And if we do the same, can also like this. More upstream, so we just swap one line to upstream. So it can be like this. But it also can be something like this. It can be everywhere. It can be upstream, downstream, upstream. We can just, depending where you put your carrier, and if your carrier have to go up or down. That's the big advantage of a network without filters. Now you are not limited anymore, and therefore you can just easily play with this to go in both directions. This way, I hope you can see in here, the throughput is much higher. First of all, we don't lose a very prime spectrum, what you normally lose when you have a crossover area, especially when you go to an ultra-high split, 492.606, then you lose 118 megahertz. If you go to 684.834, you lose 150 megahertz prime spectrum. This is a spectrum where you normally have the best communication, and you lose that just by losing the filter. We don't lose it anymore because we don't have that barrier. And therefore, you can just use your whole frequency band in this part. This also gives you an example for this. Let's say you have an out-of-band channel, a mandatory channel somewhere in your network. Doesn't matter where it is. It can be 100 megahertz, can be on 70 megahertz, can be on different parts of the network. You have a mandatory channel. So this last week we had a meeting, and they had a mandatory channel on 70 megahertz. That means that the upstream could only go to 55. Then they had a crossover area, because from 70 megahertz on, it had to be downstream. It's only a few megahertz downstream, but it has to be there. And that set, in fact, limit the upstream capacity, because you cannot go higher than that area. But with DNN, you don't have this anymore, because we still have that channel of the mandatory downstream channel, but we can have upstream around it. And therefore, it gives you a big advantage that you can have upstream, downstream, you can just swap it. And you can have, maybe you have multiple downstream carriers that are mandatory now, and maybe in the future you can switch them off. You can make them going to the upstream, so then you can move, when you have a carrier here, you can move them into the other area, you can just swap it over to upstream. It's that simple. It's just software. Your whole network becomes software-defined. It's not hardware-defined anymore. So this is the whole theory about the one touch. You put it in the network, and you don't have to go back. You touch it only once, your network, because your network has no filters. It all comes down to your remote PHY and to your modem. An example of this is, so let's say that we use a DNN to create a one touch. Let's say that we have a network like this, and we have a capacity that goes to here. That probably our network will last still here on time before we need to do something, because the capacity in the network is not enough anymore to deliver the signals that we need. So probably the first thing we do is here, we're going to upgrade to DOCSIS 3.1 high split. This is where a lot of operators are now. This will give them more capacity. And therefore, they end up that they can do this capacity up to here. And now you can see you have a couple of years ahead of you that you can now do on DOCSIS 3.1 high split. And if there is a moment, I don't know if the line goes like this, if the line goes a little more flat or more steep, it all depends on new developments. We all know that in the past years, due to COVID, suddenly the demand can change, something that you cannot predict now. So it's very difficult to predict how long that is, but there will be a moment that the existing network will not be able to cope with it anymore. So to follow the line, so the first thing we will do is we go to DOCSIS 4 high split. We are increasing the downstream. And now the downstream can do another block. And therefore, we have another capacity that we can deliver up to 1.8 gig. So we have a lot of downstream data. And then upstream catches up. We need more upstream. So then we have the third upgrade and we go to DOCSIS 4 ultra high split. And now we can have a lot of speed, a lot of data going through the network. This will buy us a lot of time going for in this direction. With DNN, we're going to do the same idea. So now we have the same situation, starting situation. So again, this is your network. This is your capacity you can do. And then the time goes to here. So now I'm going to install my 1.8 gigahertz DNN network. And at 1.8 gigahertz DNN network, give me this. Because I don't have to go back. This is the network. The network can already go directly to here. And if I maybe will do DOCSIS 3.1 and later on DOCSIS 4 and so on, it's all fine, but you don't have to go back to your network. Your network can cope with DOCSIS 3.1 and DOCSIS 4 and DOCSIS 4 ultra high split. So you don't have to go back to your network. So now again, we can deliver the same quality, the same capacity in the network with DNN as what you could do in steps over here. But this is not everything, because as I told you, we don't have a guard band. And because we don't have a guard band, we even can increase more. And they even have an extra block on top of it that we now can use for communication. So we don't use the guard band anymore. So we have more data to put in that part. That was the idea when you use DNN technology for the one touch. So the one touch is you touch a network once, and then you have a long time ahead of you where you can do changes in the network or in the system via software, different splits or whatsoever, but you don't have to visit your network. Your network is installed and will stay as is. That's the idea of one touch. But how does it work? How does a DNN amplifier works? So if I look to a DNN amplifier or a traditional amplifier, what you normally have, you have your signals coming in, you have your high and low diplex filter. So all your downstream signals, let's say 258 and higher, comes in here, goes through here, get amplified, go out. So everything above 258 will go in that direction. And everything that is below 204 comes from the upstream, comes from here, goes to here, and then go to here in this way. If I go to a DNN amplifier, I replace diplex filters for direction filters. Now it's a direction depending, not on the frequency anymore. So everything that comes from here will go in this direction. And everything that comes from here will go in this direction. So depending on where the signals come from, it goes up or down. It gets gain up or down. So that's why we say with the DNN amplifier, everything that comes down gets gain down. And everything that comes up gets gain up. That's the principle of a DNN amplifier. If we zoom more into this amplifier, then this is an example of a DNN amplifier that we are building now. We have our direction coupler. From the direction coupler, we go to just a high-pass filter on 54 megahertz. We have our attenuation, equalization, pre-stage. So this is the pre-stage, like you have in your normal amplifier. You have your interstates. Again, like a normal amplifier, you have your hybrid, your high-pass filter, another filter to go out. And on the upstream, it goes in the other direction. So if I see the signals now coming in from this part, that signal will travel through here, will go into the high-pass filter there, and through this direction filter, will come to the amplifier here, gets bigger, And then it comes to the next amplifier, gets bigger again, comes to the hybrid, again get the bigger, and then in fact the amplified signals that we have from here, coming from here, gets amplified and go in that direction. So the signals that come out is the downstream signals where we had that gain in that direction. That is the principle of the downstream. Upstream is the same. So if I look to the upstream, again, signals come from that direction. So that's why they will go here. If they go here, they go through the filters. Again, they will have an amplifier here, get bigger, go to the next amplifier, get bigger again, and then the amplified upstream signal will leave then the amplifier via the direction filter here. So combined, the up and the downstream is something like this, where you have your downstream going in that direction, your upstream comes from that direction, and you can see now in this case, you get gain in both directions. It's the same principle as a normal amplifier. A normal amplifier has a pre-stage, an interstage, a hybrid, but only they have filters to separate what goes up and down. And we have a coupler to separate if it is on the input, where the signal comes from. Does it come from this side, or does it come from that side? And that's the way how a DNN amplifier works. Simplified, but it shows you the principle of this amplifier. And that's why you see everything that comes up gets gained up, and everything that comes down gets gained down. That is the whole idea. We have developed some products for this. It's not just a theory story. We have already finished a number of products. For instance, we have our booster amplifier, the DNA. We also won that prize on the BTR awards on that for the five diamonds on this product. And this product, in fact, is a good example of the DNN technology. This goes from 54 to 1800 megahertz on the downstream, and the upstream goes all the way up to 684. So it has the full band for DOCSIS 4 the row. It's just a booster amplifier. A simple amplifier gives you 15 dB gain. That means that your input signal here will be 15 dB gain going out in that direction, and the upstream from this direction gets gain and goes out there. This is the product that you need to build your network to higher frequencies. As I told you in the beginning, you will have issues if you want to go to 1.8 gigahertz. That's your network maybe is calculated for a network of 600 megahertz. That's why cables are quite long. That's why it's very difficult to reach the next amplifier and you have to respace. Very expensive and time-consuming exercise. With this, you are just buying energy because you are just getting 15 dB gain to reach the next amplifier. This is roughly 200 meters, 600 feet of coax. So if your coax is, as an example, 1500 feet between the two big amplifiers, you put this in, then the amplifiers think it's only 900 feet of coax, because 600 feet of coax is taken care of by this device. It's very simple. You plug it in, it's done. It's only 6 watts, and that's why I said in the beginning, this will give a huge power saver, because for this, for 6 watts, you get 15 dB gain. When you look to the normal amplifiers and you want to increase your levels with 3 dB, you need to go to power doubles, double the power what you have now. So you spend 15 watts extra to win 3 dB. And here we spend 6 dB to win 15 dB down and to win about 7 dB up. So this is a product to breed that part. And this is using already the DNN technology. No filters. You put this in. You don't have to touch this area anymore. This will take care of its own. Another example, for instance, is a bigger amplifier that we use at the moment in Europe. It's a cabinet style, it's different housing that we use in the US, but the principles is the same. We have the signals coming in, we have all the downstreams, and via the tap, we will go to all the different homes. What you have here, this case, we start at 204 on customer request. So the downstream goes from 204 to 1800 megahertz, and the upstream will go from 12 to 492. So this will have a stop, 492, where you say this is your upstream, or your DNN area is between 204 and 492. So they roll this out, and they have, at the moment, DOCSIS 3.1 high split. They put this in, perfect. Upstream goes to 204. Downstream starts at 256. This product can deal with it. If I can solve the problem of the diplex filters in the modems and the diplex filters in the, for instance, in the node, I don't need a filter anymore. Your network don't have the filter. At the moment, the filter is in those two components. So if they go to later on change to 300 or 396 or 492, they can change the things around it, but they never have to change the network. The network will do it all. It's already prepared to do all these parts. This is an example. This works in combination with this tilted multi-tap here that we have developed also for this customer in this part. It's backwards compatible with the existing DOCSIS, and it is forward compatible with the new DOCSIS that is coming. Want to upgrade the power consumption in this unit to feed a number of these taps is only 22 watts. So I come back to the previous part. This is a power saver. If you compare to the amplifiers that you are using now, this will be much lower in power into what we normally put in the networks. It's full digital controlled. In fact, if you would open this housing, the only thing you will see is your USB connector and a test point and a fuse. Three things. That's the only thing you will see. Because you will have your test point to measure it. You have your USB port to control the levels on pre-stages, interstages, etc. And you have a fuse for the power supply. That's it. It's all one big box. It's the same as when you open the hood of an electrical car. When you open it, there's nothing to see. It's the same with this. There's nothing to do anymore. It's just a complete blank board because you have no filters. You have nothing left. That's the nice thing about this product. This is a small one where we have one in to go to feed a number of taps. We also developed a big one. This one here, one in, six outputs to feed to go in different directions. It's like a distribution an amplifier where you have a lot of output levels to split to go to different areas on. And this same RF specs, same frequencies, etc. This unit to feed those six coax leaving to different areas is only 38 watts. And the rest is the same. It's all AGC, ALSC, everything is embedded in it. And again, there's nothing there. It's just a fuse, it's a test point, and that's it. And a USB connector to set the levels. These are the products that we are developing at the moment or have developed in the moment. We are running a number of tests at the moment with some customers on this approach. And this is an example what DNN can do. It's simple. You plug it in. You don't have to touch it again. It's really a one-touch approach. This is just an example of a few products. We know that there will be this. We will develop more products, different style of housings, strand mount housings like you have in the US and in South America, Canada. We know that we have to go to that part. We want to walk before we run. So we do this first. We show how the technology works. We can demonstrate this also to you with these housings. And then we will start developing the other housing styles as well. This is the example of the what we are doing at the moment. So what does one touch mean? So the idea was when we talked about one touch and we had some discussions in the group. So how do we explain one touch? What is the benefit of one touch versus normal traditional network? And we tried with help from Nader in Canada, we tried to build a business case for this. This is an example of this part. This is, for instance, where we show two different technologies. This here, the dotted line, is a traditional line, traditional way of doing it, and the solid lines are the one-touch approach. So if we just first go to the dotted lines, let's say this line here is the investment that we have to do, the CapEx and the OpEx. This is the investment we have to do to run this part, to run this network. And this line here is our income. So our income, how much money do we gain by selling data? How much can we sell? So here you can see that we have this dotted line. So the break-even point of those two networks is somewhere around here. And it doesn't matter where it is on the timeline. It's just somewhere on the timeline we will have a break-even point because we will sell more data, and here's where we generate money. The solid lines is the one touch. So you can see that the return on investment of the OneTouch is less than half compared to the traditional way. But where does it come from? It comes from a couple of things. First of all, you can see that the investment is lower. And the investment is lower is because you only have to go there once. You don't have to send engineers back to change diplex filters or things like that. It's very easy install. It can be even auto-aligned. It is very accurate on auto-alignment, etc. It's just a full digital control network. You plug it in and you walk away. That's the whole idea about DNN. You don't have to go back and realign it and things like that. And also, the power consumption is much lower. There's not even put all those numbers in here, but because the power consumption is much lower, and we all know how expensive power is nowadays, and an amplifier is switched on 24/7. So to reduce the power consumption, at the end, will generate less OPEX than a normal amplifier firm. So that's why the investment will be seriously lower on a one-touch approach with DNN than compared to the other amplifiers. But the income is more. The income is more because from the start, we can sell more data. We have no crossover areas anymore. We can use that prime spectrum for data, and therefore we can push much more data through the network. At the moment, to give you an example, we build this network and we are pushing 19 gigabit of data through the network. And that 19 gigabit can be 4 up, 15 down, 5 up, 14 down, 3, 16, 16, 3. And we can just move it because we have no filters. We can decide how much blocks we use for upstream, how much blocks we use for downstream. But we can transport 19 gigabit raw data. And that means that you can do with this network, you can even do, as an example, you put your spit on 492 or 396. But if you have 396, your downstream starts at 396. And because the quality of those signals will be so outstanding that you can easily do 4K QAM all the way up to 1.8 gigahertz, that means that you can have roughly a netto DOCSIS speed through the network of 13.5 gigabit. That is 50% more than XGS-PON. So this gives you an example that you can do much more in this area, using the coax much more efficient by using an area without filters. Don't throw away the frequencies. You can use the whole area and still have the benefit. And for the upstream, it's the same, because now we have to upstream up to 492. And we have enough quality in this network easily to do 4K QAM on the upstream. We measured about 46 dB MER on the upstream. So that's a very high levels that we get out of this. Again, also, we have no filters. We have not all the group delay issues where you have on the edges of the filter and so on. It just helps the whole performance of your network. I try to put this in numbers. And I know this is a risk. Because this differs. This differs absolutely per customer, per country, where you are on the world, these numbers change. But it gives you an idea because we are comparing apples for apples. And if the apples are cheaper in your area than the apples I show here, both are cheaper. So that's why I try to still do this with the numbers. So let's say we have a traditional network and we have the one-touch network. We start with DOCSIS 3.0 low split. First thing we do is we go to DOCSIS 3.1 high split. So to do this, we have a CAPEX per homes passed. And that CAPEX per homes passed is an amplifier and taps. That's what we need to do because we talk about the networks itself. So the amplifiers and taps is roughly about $25 per homes passed. And then you talk about $400 for an amplifier divided by roughly about 20 homes. And $20 step faceplate for homes. So that gives you an average of about $25 per homes passed. OPEX, so installation cost of a tap, $60. Divided by four homes passed, about $15. Installation cost of an amplifier, about $200. Divided by 20 is about $10. So again, OPEX is also about $25 per homes passed. So this costs you about $50 per homes passed. And what you get is 9.6 gigabit raw data downstream and 1 gigabit upstream. That's what you will get with this approach to go to DOCSIS 3.1 high split. Then we go to DOCSIS 4. If we go to DOCSIS 4, we need to replace the amplifiers. Amplifiers are more expensive. We go to 1.8 gigahertz. You need to replace steps. Luckily, only faceplates, but still need to be done. OPEX is the same because you say it's the same labor that you have to put in replacing amplifiers and taps. So this is about 55. Now you have 15 down and you have about 1 gig up. And if you go to ultra high split, it's a matter of swapping diplex filters in the units, realigning it. So therefore, you will have a cost of about $12. But now you'll have about 12 gigabit down and you have about 4 gigabit up. So I talk about the flat line. I don't talk about step down or whatsoever. This is just data that you can achieve to in an ideal network that you can just run a normal tilt into all the amplifiers. Again, comparing apples for apples. I'm now going to do the DNA network. Same idea. I go to DOCSIS 3.1 high split. From here, my CapEx is about 35. This because at the end, components into 1.8 gigahertz are more expensive than components into 1.2. I use the same area what I use here. One amplifier per 20 homes passed, and one tap per 4 homes passed. So my CapEx is more expensive, although my OPEX is lower. And my OPEX is lower because I just plug this in this amplifier and I walk away. This whole new technology that we have about DNN is auto-alignment. You don't have to align it. A tap installer can install an amplifier because you don't have to align your amplifier anymore. From default, it's been told what the level should be, and it will be accurate enough to align it directly to those levels. And we are within 0.5 to be accurate on your output levels compared to our default settings. So it's, that saves you time. Therefore, it's cheaper in installation. So, but the TCO is 55 compared to 50. So it's more. And it gives you 10.1 gigabit because we have no crossover area and we have 1 gigabit up. If I do the same now to DOCSIS 4 high split, I don't have to go to my network anymore. I just get more data. And if I go to DOCSIS 4.0 ultra high split, it's the same. I don't have to go back. So I have no cost. And I have about 13 gigabit down. 4 gigabit up. This is comparing apples for apples. Because in reality, this is not 13. In reality, this can easily be 15. Because we don't have that area where you have that crossover area, and we have the quality to drive 4K PAM up to 1.8 gigahertz. In our test network, we are driving 44 dB MUR into the homes. So yes, with levels above 0 dB MV. So that means that there's more than enough to drive 4K QAM. So there are areas here. So this is just apples for apples. Again, maybe you say, yeah, but my amplifiers are more expensive or my labor is cheaper or whatsoever. It's fine, but then it counts for both sides. It's just to compare this for this. And now you see directly that, in fact, the investment here is less than half than the investment you have here over years. And that's, of course, a huge difference in this part. And not only this, also imagine how much time it will cost to do all of these things. Because you need to have the people to go back into the field to change amplifiers, to change steps. You have to have people to go back into the network to replace diplex filters. All these things that you need to do is, at the moment, we all know that we are suffering from shortage of labor. But you need a lot of labor here. And here, you only need it once. So that will be a huge saving in this area as well. So to go back to all this part, the conclusion of this part, one touch means you need to touch your network once. That's an easy sentence. I hope that was clear. That one touch means you have to touch it once. The one touch offers you a solution, not only for now, but also for the future. It are the building blocks. The DNN amplifiers are the building blocks to create the one-touch networks. So one-touch network is the system. The DNN amplifiers are the amplifiers without diplex filters, where you have the direction filters in this part. The direction neutral amplifiers can cope with the existing DOCSIS 3.0 low split, but also can go to DOCSIS 3.1 high split, DOCSIS 4.0 high split, DOCSIS 4.0 ultra high split. All these parts it can cover already directly in this amplifier. The direction neutral amplifier also support half duplex. So you can mix up and downstream. As we said, we have talked here about the OBB channels. You can have an OBB mandatory channel of the downstream in the middle of your upstream channels. And a one touch creates the flexibility to increase your capacity without visiting your access network. That was my last slide. So I don't know if there are any questions I can try to answer in the last 15 minutes.
Yes, there are. As a matter of fact, thank you, Jan. We have indeed reached the question and answer portion of the proceedings. If you've got a question for Jan, all you have to do is click in the Ask a Question box. You should see below the video screens here, and type in your question and hit the submission button. As I see a few people have done already, let's see, you were talking earlier comparing the capabilities of the network versus XGS-PON. Someone in the audience is wondering if you could perhaps compare the cost of deploying the OneTouch network versus, say, deploying a PON network.
Yeah, sure. And again, I think this differs per country. But if you look to here, the cost to deploying it in my my example of the business case that I showed here, this is roughly where we say we talk about $55 per homes passed to deploy the DNN technology. Of course, after this, you still have your cost of your power consumption of the amplifiers, etc. But overall, this will be a huge lowering cost than to run XGS-PON. So I believe some people even call this fiber wide signals because we have a wide spectrum to give to this part. We don't want to go that far, but we call this. So what you can see here, for a lower investment that you have per homes passed, using the same coax that you have already now, you can drive even more data into the home than XGS-PON can, especially on the downstream. I'm not saying the combination. XGS-PON is symmetrical, so you have up and down at the same time. But you see a lot, everybody knows that there are a lot of calculations that relationship roughly is about 1 to 10 that you need on your network. So this gives you a huge, huge pipeline for the future.
Very good. Again, if you've got a question, we have time for a few. Now's the time to ask it. Just click in the Ask a Question box, type in your question, hit the Send button. Let's see. Someone here wants to know, how much isolation is there to prevent forward signals below 492 megahertz from being amplified into the return path and vice versa?
Now, it's clearly a very technical person. Yes, that is the golden question. How much isolation do we need? In our direction couplers that we are building now, our isolation is somewhere between 60 and 70 dB. That's what we are achieving in production. In the lab here in the R&D, we were closer to the 70, but we see in production it's somewhere between 60 and 70 what we are achieving.
Very good. Let's see. Someone wants to know, because you don't have any filters, can you support FDX on a one-touch network?
Yes and no. Yes, the network can. The network can be full duplex. We have no filters. So that means, as I said before, everything that comes up gets gained up, and everything that comes down gets gained down. So I can have 100 megahertz going down, and I can have 100 megahertz going up, and they both get gained in both directions. So that works perfectly. However, our amplifiers, you can see it on the power consumption, don't use echo cancellers. It's not a very sophisticated digital system that uses echo cancellers to cancel the echoes of the units afterwards. Therefore, all the echoes has to be dealt with the remote file. That will be a struggle of that device. So if the RPD is good enough, yes, we can do full duplex DOCSIS, absolutely. The network can do it, but we don't know. At the moment, the remote file is at the moment the limiting factor to deal with all the echoes. Therefore, I would almost like to say we do full duplex with one interference group. That is what we can do, and we all know that is you have echoes from both sides. That's something that whole interference groups with full duplex is already a challenge anyhow. So we are almost the same, at least, as full duplex DOCSIS.
Very good. Again, if you've got a question, click in the ask a question box, type it in and submit it. As this person did, someone in the audience wants to know if you can run some analog channels on this platform.
Yeah, sure. It's just a normal amplifier. We don't use any digital technology for this. We don't have echo cancelers. Yes, so it's just a directional filter. Works exactly the same as every traditional amplifier. You can have analog and digital, or only analog or only digital. What you have normally in an amplifier will also go for this one. Absolutely. Good question.
All right. Someone also from the audience wants to know if one has to sweep the coax system in order to deploy.
No. No, it's not needed. At the end, it's just signals. It's signals that will go on the coax. And yes, you have a certain level. And with that certain level, we can run a certain distance. That's why I said in the beginning with DNN, maybe you have to look to the levels. We have to see what it is. We can deliver the same TCP as a normal amplifier can do. But we have some restrictions what are feasible, yes or no, on the DNN technology. So maybe on the very long runs that you have between the amplifier, in some cases you have to install that small booster amplifier. It's the size of a tap, just to gain that 15 dB to reach the next amplifier. But you don't have to sweep it. It's the same as what you have normally. You can just install it. It doesn't matter if it works with Dipax filters, it works with this as well.
Very good. Let's see. Here's a question from an audience member who states that you showed multiple upstream and downstream channels in the region between 54 and 684 megahertz. How does this align with the DOCSIS 4.0 specifications?
I don't think DNN is in the specification, but I also don't think this hurts the specification. At the end, the whole idea for DOCSIS, the DOCSIS standard says that you have upstream and downstream channels, and upstream can go to 684, downstream can start from 54. Just because we can mix them, I don't think that changes anything into the DOCSIS spec. So I think we are very compliant with the existing DOCSIS for those standards, yes.
Very good. Let's see. Someone from the audience has a question I was thinking about as well. They want to know, is the technology available for immediate deployment? And if not, what's the time to market?
Yeah, we are running several tests at the moment. So we have the amplifiers here in the lab. The DNA technology is there. The small booster ones we already sent to several customers. The bigger ones, the DNN amplifiers that we are using, we are now at the moment sampling them here. I think we have promised some customers that we will deliver the first samples for a test in February next year.
Very good. Let's see. Here's a question about the upstream and downstream signals. What is the minimum space between the upstream and downstream signals?
No, effectively zero, because you can glue them together. You don't need an area anymore. We said we don't have the network itself as yet. Can even be on top of each other. So it all comes down to how good your modem is and how good your remote PHY is to filter what is his signal and what is his signal he wants to receive or transmit. But at the end, the network itself has no filters, so has no limitation either. We run another test on this. We even did, I mentioned before that we did a 19 gigabit pipe in the DNA network. And then we played with numbers. And we had, for instance, we had our upstream up to 300 megahertz, and then we switched off one upstream carrier, put in one downstream carrier, and then directly on 308, we would continue again with upstream. So all these channels are 0 megahertz spacing. And then the MER that we measure in our equipment is still far above 40 dB MER. So it all depends on how good the filters are on your test equipment to see this, because the network itself will have no limitation at all. It doesn't have to have a filter, it doesn't have the space, it can even be on top of each other.
Very good. Let's see. Here's someone who states that 15 dB gain is sufficient for dense areas. How about rural areas with 500 meter trunks?
No, that's why we have the DNN. The DNA, the 15 dB, is indeed a small booster amplifier to that part. If we go to rural areas, we have a bigger one. At the moment, we run about 30 dB gain in those amplifiers. So I think it will depend on the situation. We would love to talk to this customer. Send us, please, a diagram what you have, and we will tell you what you need to run this part. But what we have, because the combination what we always will get is with the DNN and the DNA, we will fit 100% every solution. Because we have the benefit that if we have struggling of meeting the next amplifier because the drops are too long, we can always put in a small booster amplifier that you never have to touch, you never have to go there. You just put it in and the system continues.
Very good. Let's see. Someone would like to know if there's any interference from neighbors on the modems receiving RX from the neighbor TX.
Yeah, ADI. Now, adjacent device interference between homes has always been a struggle for every network when you are combining different technologies, upstream and downstream. And that's not different with this. If you have an old DOCSIS 3.0 modem in house A, and your neighbor has already a DOCSIS 4 ultra high split, those signals via your tap in your net, in the tap, outside tap, will leak to your neighbor, and that can impact your that area. That has nothing to do with DNN. This is exactly the same as when you go to your normal with filters, DOCSIS 4.0 ultra high split with filters and so on. Has the same problem. It's a problem that the modems on the input are not selective enough, that the AGC is too wide and therefore to be impacted by upstream signals from somebody else. If this happens, then the operator, we did a lot of discussions with operators about this. You can put a small bend stop filter in front of your old devices to stop the upstream signals of the new devices leaking to their device. Or we can discuss if there are other solutions like active solutions or something like that. There are several solutions for this problem, but this problem has nothing to do with DNN. It's a problem of mixing old and new technologies with different splits.
I think we've got time for one more question. Someone's asking, is it possible to replace line extenders and distributions of an N plus 5 network with DNN amplifiers?
No, absolutely. That's feasible. And again, it is we can put those in. We have to look to levels. Maybe we can see what the levels will do and so on. We can deliver the same TCP out of this amplifier that you have with the normal amplifier. But we have to look into it again. Does the gain fit, yes or no? Or do we have to put a booster in, etc., for the long drops? But the bottom line is we are not respacing. We are not touching that area. We are replacing amplifiers for amplifiers, and we want to keep the rest the same. And we want to keep also the power low, because that's something that at the moment is a big issue, and is issue only will become bigger going forward, that the power prices only goes up. And the power goes in both ways. First of all, it's expensive. All that power consumption that you have on your network costs you a lot of money. The second thing that you have on your power is power consumption creates heat. So you have heat in all your devices, and that will downgrade directly your MTBF. And that's why we are focusing on this area to reduce the power consumption, reduce the heat, increase the MTBF of the devices, and lower your power bill. Design your network around the OPEX part, because that's something that will be there every month again to pay the power bill. And if you can win 10, 20% on your power bill by going this technology, or even more than that, you know how much you pay on power, so you also know how much you will save.
Very good. Thank you, Jan. And with that, we've come to the end of our program today. If we didn't get a chance to answer your question just now, or you want to ask one offline, maybe you're watching this on demand, you can reach our speaker at the email address that you should see here on your screen. Meanwhile, you might want to take advantage of this final opportunity to download today's slides. You'll find them behind the Event Resources tab underneath the Ask a Question box. Now, as I mentioned at the start of the event, this session will be archived for future access. Should take about 24 hours or so. You'll receive an email with a link to the archive that you should feel free to pass around to your coworkers. And you'll also be able to find the on-demand version of the webinar on the BTR website at www.broadbandtechreport.com. Now, if you're looking for a certificate of attendance, please hang on until you see the thank you screen, and your certificate will be emailed to you automatically. Finally, I'd like to thank Jan again for sharing his expertise, Technetics for the help in making today's event possible, and of course, you and our audience for attending. Hope you'll join us for the next BTR webcast, which will take place on Tuesday, December 13th. I'll be back at that time to discuss the question, is 2023 the year you finally tame the network operations beast? Until then, goodbye, and have a great rest of your week.
Thanks, Stephen.